Good morning. Verily, verily, thou art the wise, the faithful, and the adventuresome. You are wise in that you remember to set your clocks ahead an hour last night, since you would either A, be on time for worship, or B, avoid being embarrassed when you came in just as everyone else was leaving. You're faithful in that you are here on a raw Sunday morning, and adventuresome that you took on the snowstorm. There was snow. I took a picture of it to send to my friends in Nova Scotia to tell them, see, we have snow in North Carolina too.
I know, laughing at you now.
And they just laughed. For whatever reason you are here, we are glad you're here and welcome. We invite you to record your presence with us by taking the book that's on your pew and passing it down, sign your name so that we might have a record of your presence. Then, when you finish, send it back. And then, so everybody else can know who's sitting with them. And then a new request / requirement. The last person, if you will just take it and tear off that sheet and leave it on the book, it will be wonderful and help our membership committee be able to collect those more easily. We are glad that you are here, but we are especially glad today to have our Girl Scouts with us. They will have cookies for sale, I understand, in the fellowship hall after worship, so you can't go now. I would be there. This is your last shot, probably. But the proceeds from this sale will go to Brenner Children's Hospital for the staff there who took care of one of their own this past winter. So thank you, girls, for being a part of our worship today. There are other items of interest in your worship guide. I hope that you will take the time to look over those and to review them. We are glad that you are here. But even more, we are glad that God is here. And so now let us enter into the presence of our God as we worship together.
Thank you. We, welcoming God, we gather here today to worship and praise you. We gather here in the sacred space where over many generations our forebears have gathered to worship God. Responsive God, you can hear. You hear our prayers and sighs and doubts and all our fears. We give you our thanks
for your loving awareness and care of us all.
We gather to again fulfill our commitments to our God in the presence of your people. We offer
our sacrifice, our homage, our gifts of praise, and thankfulness to our God.
Amen.
Amen.
We invite you to stand and join us in singing, if you're able, hymn number 337.
To go to a place he would later receive his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs of the same promise. For he is looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so this one man, as he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as stars in the sky and as countless as sand on the seashore.
The young, good-looking leaders of worship today are part of our Girl Scout troop. This is the Sunday in which we recognize them. And Heather's going to come and let you know some of the other things that they do, not only this Sunday, but throughout the year. Heather, thank you.
Good morning. I'm Heather Smitherman, and along with Tracy Vance,
Maddie Hamm and Blair Spellacy. I'm one of the Girl Scout troop leaders here at Kernersville Moravian. This is our 7th year of scouting, and we're grateful to the pastor, the Unified Board, and the congregation for another year of supporting our Girl Scout troops. This year, we have 14 cadets and 8 daisies. If you're doing the math in your head, that's 22. We are so proud of our cadets this year. Last year, as juniors, they earned their bronze awards, the highest award that a Girl Scout junior can earn. They spent over 20 hours researching needs in our community, interviewing experts in their fields, and completing service projects to address those needs. Our girls made blankets for patients at Brenner's Children's Hospital. They made pet care kits for those who adopt animals from the Forsyth Humane Society. And they donated over 100 duffel bags to children in foster care at Crossnore Children's Home, so they never again have to pack their belongings in trash bags. These Bronze Award projects helped our girls live out the Girl Scout law by making the world a better place. We especially want to thank the church committees and the individual congregation members whose financial donations helped make these projects possible. Our daisies are completing their 2nd year and have earned all their daisy petals. They made Build-A-Bears for the patients at Brenner's Children's Hospital, toured the Ronald McDonald House and the Forsyth Humane Society, and are looking forward to their first camping trip with their big sisters at our camperee this spring. This year, our Girl Scouts have truly made the Girl Scout law a part of their daily lives. As many of you know, our Daisy Scout, Sam Kiger, became gravely ill in October, was in critical condition for weeks, and spent nearly 4 months in the hospital. She and her big sister Maddie, who's one of my cadets, know what it means to be courageous and strong. Our Girl Scout families, who provided meals, financial aid, and lots of hugs and prayers, showed what it means to be friendly and helpful, considerate and caring, courageous and strong, and a sister to every Girl Scout. We're thrilled to announce that Sam is home today, and she is back to attending meetings with her Girl Scout sisters in person. Our daisies used part of their cookie profits this year to provide Sam with medical and school supplies that she'll need now that she's at home. And our cadets are using their money to donate cookies to the staff at Brenner's that helped save Sam's life. If you'd like to help us say thank you to our hospital heroes, or enjoy a box or two for yourselves, we'll have cookies available in the fellowship hall after worship. Thank you again for your continued support of the Girl Scout program here at Kernersville Moravian, and may God bless you all. Thank you.
Good morning. We will join our voices in the Girl Scout promise and law, with everyone sharing the bold text from the scripture, and all the current former Girl Scouts joining in the phrase of the promise and law printed in italics. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and first commandment. And the second is like this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On my honor, I will try to serve God, my country, to help people. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom has chosen his inheritance. My children, do not forget my teaching, but let your hearts keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and abundant welfare will they give you. On my honor, I will try to help people at all times.
Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven.
On my honor, I will try to live by God's outlaw. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies.
The Girl Scout law has 10 points. Each is a goal for every scout. And the scout law is, I will do my best to be honest and fair. When the ways of people please the Lord, the Lord causes even their enemies to be at peace with them.
Better is a little with righteousness than great anger with injustice.
So tell the truth and keep your promises. People can depend on you. I will do my best to be friendly and helpful.
There will never cease to be something needs on the earth.
The Lord commands you, open your hands to the poor and needy neighbors in the land. So look for ways to lift others up and listen for the ways that need to be cared for the best. I will do my best to consider and caring.
Pleasant words are like a honeycomb.
Sweetness of the soul, health in the body. So friend to everyone, even people who are very different from you. I will do my best to be courageous and strong. Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. So trust in instincts for what you know is the right thing to do in all the places where you can find yourself. I will do my best to be responsible for what I say and do. And everything do to the others as you would have them do to you. So treat others as you want to be treated. I will do my best to respect myself and others. Do you are God's temple, and God's Spirit dwells in you. For God's temple is holy, and the temple is for each one of us.
So be polite and full of compassion for everyone.
Always use good manners. I will do my best to respect authorities. As a servant of God, we live free people. Yet we do not use freedom as a pretext of evil. Honor everyone. Love your families. Fear God. So follow the rules of your family, school, and troop. Obey the laws of your community and country. I will do my best to use resources wisely. The earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it. So tend to each other
and the people around you gently.
Try not to be wasteful. Use time, food, supplies, and natural resources wisely. I will do my best to make the world a better place. Jesus said, you are the light of the world, so let the light shine before others. So face difficult situations, feel afraid, Do not think you fight, despite the others might think you were to say. I will do my best to be a sister to every Girl Scout. Be devoted to the one another, honor one another and love yourself. So ready to offer your hands and your heart to need. Support others with meeting our goals. A Girl Scout tries to live up to the law every day. It is not always easy to do, but Scouts always try.
My history with the Girl Scouts is that I was the father of a Girl Scout. My wife was the cookie mom, which was a wonderful, wonderful thing for me and for our troop. But I have learned so much about Girl Scouts and the leadership and the opportunities they gain. My youngest daughter still on a weekly or other week basis has a Zoom call with her scoots, as she calls them. They have formed friendships that have lasted through their college, through marriages, but these are the girls that she still counts on to be her best friends. So thank you very much. And thank you, our congregation, for the support you give. That is just one way in which our financial gifts goes to create an environment and opportunity for our younger people to grow. And so as we come to our time of offering, let us remember, it's just not their cookie sales. It helps support them, but our offerings and gifts as well. God, we give you thanks for the opportunities you have given us to make a difference in your world. These tithes and offerings that we offer to you are just one way in which we can do that. We pray that you will bless these gifts and all those who benefit from them. In your name we pray. Amen.
Genesis 12, 1 through 4, the call of Abram. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went as the Lord had said to him. A lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Come to our time of prayer this morning. Let us especially remember the families of Michael Cheney, who entered the more immediate presence of our Lord on Tuesday. His memorial service will be this afternoon here in our sanctuary at 3:00. We also want to remember the family of George Johnston, who entered the more immediate presence of our Lord on Wednesday. I believe that George was our oldest male member. His memorial service will be Tuesday at 2:00 in the chapel. Let us bring these families as well as the other concerns of our own lives to our Lord as we pray together. Let us pray. God, you called Abraham to leave his home on a wild adventure of faith, to go somewhere new, to a place that you would show him. And ever since then, we have looked to him as an example of faith. But God, he is not the only one, for you have provided examples to us, people we have known, have watched, people we have learned from. And we are grateful for each of them, for the examples they gave, for the lives they lived. Today, God, we thank you especially for Michael and George for their faithful lives. You were kind enough to share them with us. And now we offer them back to you, knowing that you will continue to love and care for them. At the same time, we ask that your loving presence surround their families, the ones they loved who love them. And help us seek to fill the void they leave in our congregation and our world, taking up the good work of faith that they lived. God, we change times this morning. If we are honest enough to say, that confuses us. But the fact is that time is always changing. And so we pray that you would help us rely not only what we have grown accustomed to, but to be like Abraham and walk with you in faith, knowing that your love always holds us. We offer this prayer in your loving name. Amen. The beginning is never really the beginning. There's always something that happened before, and sometimes we have to go backwards in order to go forwards. Anita and I have been looking forward for many months now to watch The Mandalorian, the latest in the Star Wars franchise. We mentioned that to our daughter the other week while we were traveling to Memphis, and she and her son-in-law looked at each other and said, "Have you seen the Book of Boba Fett?" I'm like, "No." "Well, you might want to re-watch that before you watch the new season." "No, I said, I have waited over a year to see this show. I don't want to watch 7 episodes just to get caught up. That's not fair. I want to go forward. No, she said, it will help you. And so for the past week or so, Anita and I have been spending our evenings watching a whole different show than the ones we wanted to watch. And then last night, as we were finishing up, it was like, oh, this will be helpful. This will be helpful. See, sometimes we need some background for the story we want to read. That's the case with our story about Abram this morning. We know this story. I mean, it's very familiar to us. God comes to Abram and says, go, leave where you are. Take everything you have and go to a land that I will show you. And Abram just ups and leaves. And because of that, Abram is known as the father of our faith. He is the first inductee in the Faith Hall of Fame. All the world's monotheistic faiths trace their lineage back to Abram. Paul says that his faith was counted to him as righteousness. He is the example to all of us as to what faith should look like. And this story that we heard this morning, is an important story in the Bible. In fact, John Hobart says this pericope, that's a fancy sounding word for story, is the linchpin of the entire Bible. Not just the Old Testament, but the whole scriptures, the entire Bible traces its meaning to this story. Because you see, as chapter 11 comes to a close, the first great creation story, that experiment that God had, is in a mess, an absolute mess. Hofert writes, from fruit eating to fratricide to divine human inappropriate intermingling to the great flood of the family destroying drunkenness of Rome, of Noah, to the ridiculous mud brick tower designed clearly to make a name for themselves, and to avoid scattering abroad on the face of the earth, expressly rejecting Yahweh's clear call to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Genesis 11 ends with an uncommunicative people rushing away from the ruins of their attempt to reach up to Yahweh. They have finally scattered abroad, but hardly in the ways that Yahweh had in mind. The end of chapter 11, the world is a mess. An absolute mess. It's a disaster. And it would have been easy. It would have been easy to understand if God had just thrown up her hands and said, enough! Enough! But instead, God tries something new. God calls Abram. But who is Abram? I mean, it's like he just fell out of the sky. It's like we have come into the show not having watched the previous episodes. We don't know who he is or where he came from. And that's why we have to go backwards a little bit to read another story. Let's be honest. If you read the first few chapters of Genesis, once you get past the Tower of Babel, we don't read much further. I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt that you have read that far, okay? And you understand why. Because Genesis 11 is all genealogy. All of it. And who reads genealogy? I mean, how excited would you be this December, on the second Sunday of Advent, if the scripture lessons were Matthew 1, the begats? Who reads those? Nobody. Nobody reads the begats. We just skip over it. We don't care if it's Jesus' family tree. We skip it. So are we really going to get excited in Genesis 11 to find that great spiritual inspiration that comes from reading, when Selah had lived 30 years, he became the father of Eber. Does it just strike your soul? Selah and Eber, they only show up one other time in the entire Bible, and that's in the book of Chronicles, which just happens to be another genealogy. So we just skip over it. We just skip it. We turn the page and get on with the story. But I want to suggest when we do that, we miss something very, very important. I know. I did that recently. Because if we read just the last two verses of chapter 11, we hear this story that shines a light on everything that is to come. It says, Terah took his son Abram and grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, his son's Abram's wife, and they went out together from Ur of the Chaldees to go to the land of Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Catch it? Did you hear it? Hidden right in the middle of all that boring genealogy stuff. And I'm not talking about the fact that Terah lived to be 205 years old. I doubt if he really did, but that's another story. But did you catch the part? Terah, Abram's family, went out from Ur of the Chaldees to go to the land of Canaan. He left Ur of the Chaldees to go to the land of Canaan. He was going to the promised land. But when he got to Haran, they settled there. We're going to the promised land. That was his destination. That's where he was heading. But when he got to Haran, he settled. You can understand why. Haran was a commercial center in what is now Turkey. Located on the trade routes, it had all the ancient conveniences that one could want. It was a good place to live. It was a great place to raise a family. I mean, it was good enough. And so they settled. You see, in our world, many times settling is a good thing, right? It means you're grown up, means you're responsible. I mean, when you have a room full of unruly children, when they're running around screaming, jumping on the furniture, what do you tell them? Settle down. Settle down. Grow up, be responsible. Follow the rules, the dictates, the norms. Do what you're supposed to do. Settle down. In our world, settling down is a good thing. It's what we want to do. It was about 9 months ago when Anita and I put all our worldly goods in the back of an Atlas truck for our move from Canada. We were going to Memphis, not sure where or why. Well, our grandson is there, that's why we were going there. But we put all our stuff in this Atlas truck, and they took it and they put it in the storage unit. When we came here, we didn't bring all of it. We brought some of it because we were only going to be here for a few months, right? And so most of it remained in that storage unit in Memphis. It was good and it was safe. But there were times when we would be doing something at the house and he would say, Just the other week I was working on a sermon and I reached up on the shelf to get a book that I know I needed. It was in the storage unit in Memphis. And so last weekend while we were there, We spent 2 hours or more in this storage unit trying to go through boxes, finding stuff that we needed, because you have been gracious enough and wonderful enough to invite us to be here for a few more months. And to be honest, we just want to settle. We just want to settle. It's a good thing. And apparently it was a good enough thing for Turok. He settled in Haran, and he raised his family there, and everything seemed to be going well. That's where Abram grew up, started his business, became rather successful. Abram had grown up there and was settled there. But settling, as much as we love it, is not valued in the Bible. Settling in the Bible means to stagnate, to become barren, to die. And so God calls to Abram, leave. Pull up your stakes, pack everything up, leave your family, your culture, your security, and go to a place I will show you. Have you ever thought, how did that message come to Abram? Do you think he was sitting out under the tree in Haran? It's the only tree there. You know, if you're there, you see it. He was out there one night and the wind blew. He heard an almost audible voice saying, Abram, Abram, leave. Or was it the stories he heard his father tell as the family gathered for meals, how the dreams he had of that new place they were going to go to, that land called Canaan? Or it could have been just a nudging, that sense deep inside him that the life he was living wasn't everything that life could be. Even though he was successful and had all the trappings of the good life that came with it, there was a sense that there could be more. That he could be something more. Or was it just a psychic break? After all, why? Why would you leave a good life to go to a land I will show you? I have a friend who's a counselor who told me that she had a client that whenever he knew he was in trouble, whenever he heard God calling him to go on a mission, it came time for him, he knew it was just time for him to adjust his medication. Because one time he had driven all the way across the country on a whim, just because God had told him to. He just needed his medication adjusted. And you know that there were some people in Haran who thought that about Abram. Abram, what are you doing? I mean, he's 75 years old, and now you're just going to pull up stakes for what? For some wild quest? Abram, you do remember, you're the oldest son. You have the responsibility of taking care of your father, and now you're just going to walk away from all of that? You're going to abandon everything you have? You're going to abandon your father? Abram, you're the firstborn, which means that when your father dies, you get it all. You're going to walk away from all of that and leave it on the table to go where? What did it take to get Abram's attention? Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house and go to a land I will show you. How many nights did Abram toss and turn with that call echoing in his soul? How many nights did he stand on the edge of town, peering out into the distance to that land where nothing was moving? There wasn't anything out there as far as he could see. How many times did he decide, today? Today's the day that I'm going to go tell Dad that we're leaving and Sarah and I will start packing up and leave. Only to have his fear rise up inside him and choke the words before they could come out of his mouth. You see, it's so easy for us to read this story and sentimentalize it because of course, Abram is the father of our faith, right? It's easy to believe that this was an easy decision for him to make. It's easy for us to forget that he was leaving everything. Everything that he had known, his family, his business, his traditions, his culture, his security. He was leaving it all for what? For what? For the call of God. For you see, God is always calling us to leave our steeliness, our steadiness, to venture out, to go beyond. Walter Brueggemann has written that God's call is always one to abandonment, renunciation, and relinquishment. It is a call for a dangerous departure from the presumed world of norms and security. Our narrative knows that such a departure from security is the only way out of barrenness. The whole of the Abrahamic narrative is premised on this seeming contradiction. To stay in safety is to remain barren. To leave in risk is to have hope. We know the fear of leaving, don't we? Of being unsettled. The fear of going into the unknown. We have that fear as individuals. I remember the day we arrived in Nova Scotia after 20 years in Charleston on the sandy beaches. We arrived in Nova Scotia. It was snowing. It was 10 degrees, and I looked at Anita and said, "What have we done?" We know that fear. We know that fear as individuals, but we also know it as congregations. We feel it as we come out of COVID, wondering what happens now. Is there any way to go back to the world that was? We see it every Sunday, don't we? That we're in the middle of something that's unsettled. I mean, we see it. On the front of our worship guide, right there in front of my name, transition pastor. Something very different than a settled pastor, isn't it? Settled pastor means things are steady, secure. We know what to expect. And we like knowing, don't we? But like Brueggemann reminds us, God continually calls us to venture out into a dangerous departure from the presumed world of norms and security. To stay in safety is to remain barren. To leave in risk is to have hope. So, I have to ask us, are we willing to venture out of our norms, away from our security? Or we want to cling to our past security to the very end? We're not going to change anything, no matter what. How much are we going to hamstring our next pastor with our ways of doing things? Are we going to be willing to take some risk, to live into our anxieties, our fears, our callings? It's always scary. On a quasi-regular basis, I call my friend Dave Odom at Duke Divinity School. We all know that church is changing, and Dave knows more about church than any other person I know. And so I call him from time to time when my anxiety gets high, and I say, "Dave, what is church going to look like in 5 years? Just tell me, and I know we can get there. I can plot a course there. Tell me, Dave, what's it going to look like?" And Dave says, as he laughs, "Don, nobody knows. You have to make it up." Just make it up. Dave, I don't call you for that kind of stuff. I call you to tell me the answer. But there's not the answer. We're always having to live out our faithfulness. To just make it up with the faithful hope that we really are hearing God's call. And having heard that call, be willing to follow. And we're not always going to get it right. Abraham didn't. He didn't. Read his story. It's a story that doesn't make the lectionary, so you may not have known this. But on two different occasions, not once, but twice, Abraham tried to sell his wife off to save his skin. This is the father of our faith. He didn't always get it right. But if you read on down in our passage this morning, a little verses just past what we heard, we read that Abraham journeyed by stages. By stages. Bit by bit, stage by stage. As we drove home from Memphis this week at night, we were listening to a podcast by Kate Bowler, a conversation that she was having with Frank Bruni, a columnist for the New York Times. And he recounted that E.L. Doctorow's once said that writing a novel is like driving a car at night. You have your headlights, but they don't show you all the road ahead. Just as much, they show you just enough of the road ahead as you need to see. And then the next segment, and the next segment, and then the next. That's how we live in faith. We move like Abraham, by stages, bit by bit by bit. Brothers and sisters, I pray that we might have the faith and the courage of Abraham and Sarah to listen to God's call, to let go, and to respond to God's invitation to the adventure. It will change us, and it might just even change our world. Thanks be to God. Amen. In response, I invite us to stand if you are able and join us in singing hymn 732, In Heavenly Love Abide. worship this day. And Scouts, thank you so very much for adding to our worship service today, but also for what you add to our community. We look forward to seeing what you're going to do in the future. They will have cookies, except Thin Mints. Those are all mine. But thank you. Please remember Michael Cheney and George Johnstone's families this week. Michael's memorial service today at 3. They will be receiving friends in the fellowship hall at 2:00. There are opportunities for us this week. I hope you will take advantage of them. Remember our Bible study and dinner on Wednesday evening. I have enjoyed the time so far. Hope that you have, and invite you to join us on Wednesday evening at 6:00 for dinner in the fellowship hall. We go now to join God on this wild adventure of faith. So as we go, may we hear our benediction. You are the people of God. So go now, and as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God give you grace never to sell yourself short, to risk something big for something good. God give you grace to remember that our world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So go now, and as you go, may the Lord take your hands and work through them. May the Lord take your lips and speak through them. May the Lord take your hearts and set them on fire, both now and forevermore.